Today on the Bass Channel, we're checking out a new bass bridge design from Ray Ross. So first of all, I understand it has been a little while since I've been in front of the camera. Thank you very much. I know that I've been missed. That's not true. This guy didn't like me very much. But this, as you remember, is my green 2017 Fender Special Edition Deluxe PJ. This has kind of become the home of all of the cool bass parts that we check out on the channel, including the Hipshot detuner, the EMG pickups, and of course, this saddleless bass bridge. So obviously, there is a tremendous amount of options when it comes to aftermarket bass bridges, and I think that we can probably all agree that the stock, off-the-shelf MIM Fender bent steel model is arguably the worst of them all. Outside of that, you have a bunch of options that are kind of modeled after the Leoquan Badass, whether it be the Omega Bridge, the Kick-Ass Bridge, the I'm blanking on some names, but here they are right here bridge. Basically, what these bridges have in common is that A, they're high mass. The other thing that they have in common, like every bridge on the market, is that you have a fixed point where the ball end is held or captured, which then the string feeds over a saddle, giving it a break angle or a kink. As you can see, this bridge doesn't have that. The ball end sits right in the peg, and it comes straight out, giving you absolutely zero kink in the string. So naturally, there are a lot of advantages to this, and just to make sure I don't get anything wrong, I'm just gonna let you know what the box says. Rather than utilizing a traditional saddle to prevent a string break, the Ray Ross, registered trademark, features a tone pin that keeps the string completely straight from the bridge to the nut. This concept removes the kink from the string, providing increased vibrational energy through the strings and into the body of the instrument. This feature allows maximum transference to the instrument so you can get the most of the bass itself, not solely the color of the bridge. On a standard bridge, the downward force applied to the instrument from the string is restricted due to the saddles providing relief between the string and body. The Ray Ross negates this concept and applies nearly 100% of the string tension downward, allowing the string to resonate freely, giving the cleanest possible path from your fingertips to your ears. Okay, so there's a number of ways that we could have done this video, and if I'm being honest with you, this video has been in the works for far too long. But here we are finally doing it, and many of you have asked us for a, I guess, a more opinion-based, less scripted, off-the-cuff kind of how I feel about the product. So obviously the box mentions that you get increased string energy, increased sustain, increased harmonic content, all of those buzzwords. Right off the bat, I can tell you that I don't wanna say it doesn't, but in my experience, again, I've owned this bass for coming up on 5 years, the amount of harmonic content I would say is negligible. I did notice that there was a little bit of increased string energy. Now, again, that could maybe be to the fact that, you know, the strings are new, maybe a little bit of placebo effect going on, who knows, but all I know is that when I'm playing it, I do feel more string energy in my left thumb. So what the science of how that works would suggest is that since the bridge is more high mass, it's rejecting the energy the string is outputting at the bridge, giving it back to the string, which is maybe why I'm feeling it more on my thumb. I know that sounds a little batshit, but maybe that's what it is. So other than for that, I can't really attest to the tonal differences or moreover the tonal benefits of having this type of a design. What I can tell you, now I understand that this is not very common, but I, in the course of my music career, if you could call it that, have broken two bass strings, one A, one E. The first one was the E, and I don't remember if it broke at the nut or the saddle, but I do know for a fact that when I broke that A string, it definitely broke at the bridge. So for me personally, eliminating the break angle on what sometimes could be a relatively sharp saddle gives me a little bit more peace of mind knowing that I can really just kind of go to town and hit it and not have to worry about that string breaking at any kind of weak points, which really there kind of are none now, if you're assuming your nut is cut correctly. Also, the other thing that I really loved is the way that this bridge adjusts, whether it be the intonation or the string height. It comes with the tool that you need. The tool has no, you know, it's not hexagonal like an Allen wrench or anything like that. It's just a round tool. And honestly, both the intonation and the string height work very similarly to the truss rod adjustment that you'd see in like a Music Man Stingray. And so it's really easy. It's really satisfying to do. And finally, the thing that I like the most personally is, I'll be honest, doing these types of videos for almost 6 years now, you get a little jaded to how many people want to cling to the old school method. If it's not tried and true, it must not be as good. Everybody wants the 57P bass sound. We all want passive pickups. We all want vintage spec. I agree the anodized pickguard does look awesome, but it's time, at least for me, to move on. So it's really refreshing for me to see not only somebody take the risk of innovating something that's never really been seen before, but that it's successful, it works. Maybe it's superior, maybe it's not, but it's definitely not inferior. So for me, I am always a proponent. I'm always on the team of where else can we take it that is not another 57P bass. Like, I mean, I know we have a jazz pickup, but like, I've brought this up in videos before. Like, what is that much different about this P bass than a P bass that you could have got 60 years ago? Not a lot. Now there is. We have a different style of bridge. So the more that the music industry can move in that direction, and the more people can open their minds and not, it's not how it used to be. I always really love that. So therefore, I'm gonna champion this bridge. I'm gonna champion the idea of innovation and moving forward and trying something new and different and not just sticking to the old ways for the sake of tradition. Now, this is my first experience with this bridge. So far, I have really nothing but positive things to say about it. However, over the last couple weeks, maybe a month or so, you guys have gotten to know my friend Dave Dixon. He's the one who kind of turned me on to this bridge, and he has a bass that features this bridge. So he's got a little bit longer of an experience than I do with it. So I'm gonna jump out of frame. You all can sigh some relief. Dave's gonna jump in and just kind of give you the rundown of his experience that he's had with the bridge on his particular bass.
I'm not unfamiliar with the reception that the Ray Ross bass bridge got. When it was unveiled, I wanna say 2.5 years ago, it was early 2019, and hell, there was a 20-page talk bass forum post about it, thread about it. And basically what was happening was you had people on the one side saying, hey, hooray for innovation, I haven't seen anything like this before, this sounds like a cool idea. Then you had some people saying, well, it's kind of solving a problem that doesn't exist, and so I don't know why this design exists. And then you had the people on the extreme opposite end from the lovers that seemed to focus on potential for hazard or subpar construction issues. So people said, oh, the tone pins, that when the string is being anchored at a vertical member of the assembly, the risk is that it's gonna bend forward and snap off and shoot off into the audience and take 17 people's eyes out. Well, sure, that was probably a potential pitfall of this bridge design, but I think being milled out of solid brass of decently large stock, you know, has really made that kind of a non-starter of a concern. As for me, when I was working on kind of building, kind of assembling a bass, I got some help from my friends up at Brubaker Guitars, and the Ray Ross bridge was an option that Brubaker offers. I think he still does. And so I said, hey, let's try it. It looks like a cool design, and this is the bass. You might have seen this on my Instagram, but this is my steampunk bass that I call the Electric Teapot. And it's got, obviously all this cool brass hardware. And so I got the raw brass version of the Ray Ross bridge. And I have enjoyed it ever since. It really sounds good. Thing is, this bass has never had another bridge, so I don't know what it would have sounded like with a bent metal bridge or a badass bridge or something like that. But for my money, the Ray Ross bridge has done very nicely for me. It's sufficiently bright. It returns a lot of the energy back to the string. These are chromes, so they're D'Addario chrome flat wound strings. So I wanted a little bit of extra brightness and a little bit of extra sustain because you know how flats tend to go. And sorry, the dogs are barking. And so, yeah, so I like the bridge. I'm not going to say, you know, that I know that there's, you know, 87,000% more sustain or brightness or anything like that. And one of the reasons that we didn't take this video into a comparison back-to-back kind of thing is because we don't have the scientific equipment and test setup quite yet to be able to do a quantitative real comparison. By the time the audio gets to you on the other end out there in YouTube land, it's been compressed and run through a couple of codecs and compressed probably again and then translated back out into speakers. So I would say for, I think these are about $140 for the bridge, you know, it might be worth testing yourself, especially because it's just a direct drop-in for a Fender style bridge. The only thing that I've ever seen personally that might impact the tone quality of the bridge is you might get a little bit of that kind of chorusing, ghosting kind of a sound if the action wheel is a little bit loose up against the tone pin. So just make sure that everything is kind of all snug and right where you want it, and you should avoid any of that kind of problem. So that is me and my experience with this bridge. Basically, there's going to be naysayers for any new design. Again, your mileage may vary. I like this bridge a lot. Chris seems to like this bridge a lot. He was very excited when I showed him my bass, and that's, you know, kind of where the genesis of this whole video came from. Either way, we're always about innovation, and I think a new bridge model, something that gives you a little bit of a difference in the way you set up your instrument, a little bit of difference in the assembly of the piece itself, it just gives you another option. So next time you're out there shopping for bridges, you could go for a Badass, you could go for a KMS, you could go for individual bridge rails, or you could go for the Ray Ross bridge. And I have no qualms recommending the Ray Ross bridge myself. And you know, we'll see over the next few months. We'll come back to it in a little while and say, you know, hey, Chris, how's that PJ doing with the Ray Ross on it? And, you know, we'll talk about it. And hopefully we can get to a scientific demo as well. So without further ado, I'm going to toss it back to Chris in the studio, the same studio I'm sitting in now. And, you know, thanks for listening to me rant about it or rave about it or talk about it for far too long. Adios.
Okay, and there you have it. Like Dave said a minute ago, there are a number of ways that we could have gone about showing this video. We've done bridge videos in the past, and obviously it's really easy to show the install. The fact that this was a direct retrofit, the 5 bolts just fit right in, no problem, no extra drilling. As far as showing off the differences in tone, without the proper equipment, it becomes subjective very quickly. Who's to say when the note stops ringing out? Who's to say, to a degree, if this note was louder or this note had more harmonic content, particularly in the sense that, you know, a lot of these sound samples, even if they don't go through an amplifier, they're in a video. They're gonna go up to YouTube. YouTube's gonna compress the living hell out of it. So without some type of indisputable physical visual representation of what's going on, it's really hard to say. And, you know, you do get into some minor inconsistencies in the strings, even though I bought the same brand of string. Who knows if there's inconsistencies within it? So it's a little tough, but I have to say, in the spirit of doing something different, breaking free from the norm, innovating, trying something new, taking a risk, that's kind of what we're doing here. It would have been easy to have Josh or Will or Jamie or Chuck or whoever play a bunch of samples on the stock bridge and play a bunch of samples on this bridge and have you guys argue over which one sounded better. Or we could just take a minute, relax, and just talk about a product that we think is cool. You might like it, you might hate it. but at least you know it exists, you know a little bit more about it, what it looks like, how it installs, and some of the merits behind the design. So again, let us know in the comments what you think. Do you like it? Do you hate it? Do you like the way it looks? Do you like the way it adjusts like I do? Have you tried one? Do you own one? What are your thoughts? We want to know all that. Get a discussion going down below. Of course, it helps this video out as far as YouTube's ever-changing algorithm. So with that, I'm going to jump out of here. Hope you guys have been enjoying the content, and I hope you continue to enjoy the content that is still to come. So with that, I'm Chris. This is the Bass Channel. This is the Ray Ross Saddleless Bass Bridge, and we'll see you next time.